So how did your boy Leon fumble his own bags and miss out on a five-figure potential deal with a huge company entering the Web3 space? And what are the three things you can learn from this experience as an NFT project founder, as a creator, and as an entrepreneur so you don't commit the same mistakes I did? So very quick story, I one day have two representatives from this huge Canadian company that get in touch with me, and they are launching a new innovative product in the domain space. For privacy reason, I won't be saying who the company is, but what they are building is a Web2 to Web3 domain that connects the two, so you only need one domain for both your Web2 website and your Web3 wallet. It connects everything together. Pretty innovative. It's something we haven't really seen yet at scale in the NFT space. So they get in touch with me through the YouTube video. They've watched one of my YouTube videos. We hop on a call. They tell me that they absolutely love what I've been doing. They love our website. They love our case study. And they wanted to learn a little bit more about how we could potentially help them with their go-to-market strategy for their new product that they are going to be rolling out in 6 months. I'm like, okay, perfect. So I get to know a little bit those two representatives. I get to know their company. I get to know their product. And I get to know what are their needs and desires in the context of Web3. So they have great expertise in Web2, but they're not too sure how to navigate the new turbulent space of Web3. And they need help with people that have already been through this process and that can help them navigate the space. I'm like, perfect. Okay, so this definitely sounds like something we can help with. Here's what we've done, and here's how we could potentially help with what you guys are doing. The two representatives were ecstatic. They loved what they heard. They thought that this was definitely something that could help them. They were like, amazing, Leon. I love that. So the rates you gave us, which was a low five-figure contract, worked for them, and they asked me for a proposal. So that same day, I send their legal team the proposal. They approve it, and we set up a follow-up call with those two representatives. So they're like, Leon, okay, so everything seems to be coming in place. The final step is just for you to hop on a call with the big boss and just get his approval so he can sign off on this investment. I'm like, okay, perfect. I'll be ready for that meeting with the big boss. So out of excitement, I hop off the call and I start working on the presentation that I'm gonna have for the big boss, because I was told that, hey, make sure you come to that meeting prepared with action steps, not just theory, not just ideas. Actually have certain action steps that how you're going to be helping our company. So I start working on that presentation, have it ready the same day. So we go on a back and forth with the big boss on by email, and we end up setting up a call in 2 weeks. I'm like, perfect. So 2 weeks after, it was a third day. Meeting was happening at 2 p.m. If you guys don't know, I work at a WeWork space, which is kind of a big shared co-working space. I was sitting in the busy area and I was getting ready for this meeting. So I go try looking for a new spot. So the place was pretty busy at 2 p.m. It was lunchtime. I go up and down three floors. And by the time I found a quiet spot at the very corner of the floor, it's already two. It's already time for the meeting. So I go on Google Calendar, I click on the link, and shit, all of a sudden I notice it's a Zoom link, not a Google Meets, which I'm more used to. So I click on Zoom, and guess what? Zoom always does that at the best of timings. There's an update, and Zoom needs to update. So I clicked on update and hopped on my phone, connected my AirPods. With my video off, I hop on the call, and the big boss was already there. So I hop in, camera off. I'm like, hey man, nice to meet you. Just wanted to let you know my Zoom is playing with me. I'm going to be on in 2 minutes. So I had already started off on a bad foot, showed that I was not ready. Anyways, I connect on my laptop 2 minutes after, hop on, videos on. I was sitting on a side corner of the room, dark background, you know, me trying to create reports with the guy. So you're in Canada? Yes. Oh, me too. I've been living in Montreal for the past decade. Sweet. And then I asked him a question that was complete blunter. Hey man, so you are the founder of that big company in Canada. He looks at me. He's like, no, I'm not the founder of this company. I'm the founder of the company under it. Because it turns out there's the one big Canadian company, and then they have multiple smaller departments like Alphabet, where they have YouTube, Google, Cloud, all these little other products under it. And he was the founder of new initiatives that was under the mother company. And for me, I had confused the two together. So already in front of someone's face, I confused them for someone they're not. And the fact they had to tell me, no, I'm actually not this guy, I'm that guy. Ooh, all of a sudden, I realized that this meeting, 3 minutes in, it started a bad note. Hopped in, camera off. Not ready. Number two, confuse the guy. I'm like, okay, Leon, you have to take control of this call. So what I do, I'm like, hey man, so are we expecting the other two representatives on that call? He's like, no, it's just you and I. I'm like, okay, perfect. I actually have a presentation ready for us today. I kind of get ready to make this session productive. He's like, perfect, Leon, just before we start, who are you? And when he asked me this, this is not a question that I had expected, because for 99.9% of all my calls, these are people that have been watching my YouTube channel. They've gone through our website. They've gone through my social media. They know a little bit who I am, what I do, what I've worked on, our case studies, just like the two representatives before. But for him, he came for the very first time, and I was not ready to answer this question. Had never answered it before, by the way. I've conducted over 500 sales calls with different founders and was never asked this question. So definitely caught me off guard, stumbled on my words a little bit, didn't give him a very strong answer. I was like, okay, man, perfect. Let's get started. So I was like, fuck. Okay, this is not going well. Couple slides into the presentation, I'm sitting here, and what I did receive from the representatives that was helpful was a list of all the 15 marketing things they needed help on. So I was like, okay, man, so here are the 15 things you need help on. Here's the ones we can help and we have the expertise to help with. And halfway as I was presenting one by one what these things were, he stops me and he's like, Leon, with all due respect, you don't need to go through those all one by one. I'm like, yeah, of course, of course. So I skipped two slides in to the proposal, to the part where, okay, so here's what we're gonna do and here's how we can help you guys. And these were broken down into four main categories. By the second one, as I was going through it, he looks at me, he stops me there. He's like, Leon, I don't wanna be impolite, but I don't think this is a good fit. So very politely, I sit here and I'm like, yeah, of course, man. Like, which one of those do you think doesn't work for you guys? He's like, all of them. None of what you have written here would work for us. I'm like, okay, like, sure. Like, what is it that you guys were looking for that is not here? So then he tells me that they were looking to hire in-house and they weren't looking to outsource that to a contractor. So in my head, I'm like, fuck, I just fumbled my own bags to potentially working with a company that could act as a stepping stone for my business, for my career, for my team, for all the people, their family, everyone that could depend on their team. What I did is I completely fumbled my bags. And what happened after the call, what was supposed to be a 30-minute call got wrapped up in 15 minutes. We left the call, try to provide as much value as I can leading up to the call. Like, hey man, okay, I completely respect that this is not a good fit. Here's just my key takeaways that you guys should implement now that you're in the market. He takes notes, appreciates it. And then we hop off the call and all of a sudden I have an extra 15 minutes that are free that were supposed to be scheduled for that call. So I sit here and I take some notes over all the things I did wrong and why I was feeling a little bit disappointed about myself, because that was definitely not a good performance. Sales for me is something that is very crucial. It's sacrament to me. I had spent dozens of hours starting the art of sales. I've invested in some of the best sales course. I've read all the sales books and I had broken every sales rule during that call. And really the lessons that I've learned from this experience that I hope you also learn so you don't make the same mistakes as you're speaking with potential investors, with ambassadors, with recruiters, whoever it is you're speaking with. I hope you don't commit the same mistakes and potentially miss out on what could be a life-changing opportunity for you. So it all comes down to three main takeaways that I have. So the first one is I came to the call unprepared and my prospect felt it. I had my camera off. I didn't have my software figured out correctly. I didn't know who I was speaking with. So all of a sudden, I did not appear as an authority figure in this space. There's this common misconception that people work with people they like. For me, I don't agree with that. I think people work with people they respect. And coming into the call, I did not show that I respected the guy. And why would he respect me if I don't respect him? So that was the first thing I did wrong. Always be prepared and always know who you are talking to and make sure you're ready for the call in a quiet space. Number two thing I did wrong. If you guys know The Wolf of Wall Street, The Wolf of Wall Street is based on the real story of Jordan Belfort. And Jordan Belfort is known for his sales system called the straight line selling system. And I actually took the straight line selling course. And there's one thing he mentions that every salesman should have when hopping on a call with the prospect. The first thing is he need to be enthusiastic as hell. People want to make business with people that are happy overall. No one wants someone that's depressed. Number two, you need to be sharp on the call. People need to feel like you got it. Number three, you need to be seen as an authority figure. People listen to authority figures. And this is something we were hardwired and trained from a very young age. People want to work with authority figures. And the first thing that happened, again, started with the first bad impression that I was not ready. Number two, when we transitioned and he asked me, who are you? And I wasn't able to answer that sharply. All of a sudden, I was not sharp. He did not see me as an authority. He did not see me as sharp. And all of a sudden, I had lost the first impression on that call. So number two, always be sharp. Always have what you're gonna say ready. The moment you fumble your words is the moment you lose credibility in the eyes of potential prospects. And number three, which is the biggest mistake out of the three mistakes, is that I had failed to answer people's needs and desires. I make it a point for all my sales calls that the very first 25 minutes of a 30-minute call is the person that is with me on the call is talking. I am learning about them. I am learning about what their needs are, what their background is, why they are building a project in the Web3 space. Why is that important for them? Why are they choosing to go this route instead of starting a business in Web2 or Web1 or whatever it is? Why is it important for the prospect, and how does he see us fit within his project? So the person is talking, they are opening their heart, they're sharing with me what is it they need, and if I feel like what we have is right for them, only then do I tell them. And what this allows me to do is to package what I have, what I offer, in a way that works for them. Because the way we help a project is on a very wide spectrum. Some people, they need more one-on-one hand-holding, they need a bit more accompaniment. So if I know this, I can all of a sudden highlight how much my team and I is gonna spend time with the person, how much we're gonna handhold them, accompany them through their journey. Maybe some other people, they want something that is more personalized for their project. I can highlight that part. With the big boss, when I hopped on that call, I had failed to adapt to the changing situation once I realized that the person in front of me had absolutely no context over what is it that we did, who I was, and I had no idea over what is it that he exactly needed and he was looking for. And although he packaged it in the sense where, oh, we're looking to hire in-house, that is not true. Because what I learned from sales is that people are never rigid about what is it that they need. They are open to options that they deem as more valuable than what is already out there. Obviously, they have preference. Maybe they want to build an in-house culture, tax situation, whatever. But imagine you are, for example, in New York City and you're looking to buy a new car. Obviously, you're going to shop for a car that is already in New York City. But what if I call you up and I'm in Madrid? I call you on like, hey man, I have this Bentley right here that I don't know what to do with. I'm traveling tomorrow and I need to get rid of it overnight. I'll sell it for you for $5,000. A Bentley for $5,000. And you're in New York City. Don't you think that you are going to find anything it takes to get your hands on that Bentley? You're going to fly to Madrid, first ticket, you're going to find a shipping company and you're going to ship it to the US because you see value in the offer that I gave you, which is a Bentley for $5,000. And you will go out of your way to get your hands on that. And what I had failed to do on that call is I had failed to understand what is it that he was looking for. And instead, I just came in assuming that I knew and I started telling him about what is it that we did. Never, ever again. Please always seek to learn what is it that the other person needs? What is it that they want? And then you can understand how do you fit within their vision, within what they need. And this is a very big mistake that I very, very, very often see on Twitter. I always get DMs from random NFT projects that are asking me, hey Leon, can you please give me feedback on your thing? Hey Leon, please join our whitelist. Hey Leon, here's a free thing. People give without even asking what is it that I'm looking for. Me as an NFT participant, I have certain core needs and desires. And if a project, an entrepreneur, a content creator, whoever that is, comes in and identifies what is it that I need and all of a sudden positions themselves as the vehicle for that, my chances of answering them and saying yes to them is going to be a lot higher. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if I had done all those things on that call with the big boss, would it have been guaranteed that I would have gotten the green light and the contract would have been signed? No, but it would have definitely increased the odds of this happening. So ladies and gentlemen, really, here are the three things you can learn so you don't commit the same mistakes that I did. Number one, always be ready. Number two, be sharp as a tack. And number three, always position yourself as the vehicle for people's desires and needs. I embrace this as a great learning journey because doing sales calls like these in the NFT space, and I have to say by the end, I've conducted again over 500 calls. I got a little bit too comfortable. And what happened with that Canadian company, I like to think was the best outcome that could have happened because number one, it taught me these lessons that perhaps in the future could have saved me a six-figure deal instead of it being a five-figure deal. And number two, it did remind me that, hey, Leon, you know, you gotta stay sharp as well and not get too comfortable. So hey, ladies and gentlemen, this was it. I hope you learned from this video and you keep crushing it. Whatever it is you're building, if you right now are someone building during this market, I salute you and I respect you and you have my support at every step of the way. I'll see you on the very next video. Ciao.